Okay. This is what you said you were going to do, and you're going to do it because you promised everybody you would do it, and you know that it would be best if you do it. So you're going to go, and you're going to tell a story, and you're going to own the story, and other people will see the story.
Makes you beautiful. Don't let nobody ever make you doubt it. Yeah. Your heart is free and strong.
That's what keeps you keeping on.
Can't keep it down. There ain't no doubt about it. Yeah.
The night before I began junior high school, I had a grand mal panic attack. It was 1988. I was 11, and I had been to the movies earlier that day to see Who Framed Roger Rabbit. I'd seen it before, in the same theater actually, with my mother and my brother, but my friend, my only friend, Maria, had invited me out to see it with her. She was going with her mother and her two nieces. She had much older siblings, and her sister had two daughters, so nieces. And all us ladies went to the movies and watched it, and it was just as good the second time as it was the first, but I didn't enjoy myself. Because the entire time, there was a knot growing in my stomach. Couldn't swallow my candy, and was freaking out more and more by the second. And this is before I knew what panic attacks were. I just knew I felt weird, you know? I didn't have the vocabulary at 11 to explain mental health at all. I don't think any of us did. Now, I came home, and sometime later, I was sitting with my mother on the couch, and she asked me if I was prepared for tomorrow. And I burst out crying, because I was not. No amount of putting my clothing together, or putting everything in my bag, or figuring out the route to walk to school, or how to fix my hair, or what time to wake up. You know, nothing of that kind was being prepared for school, because I wasn't mentally prepared. Now, I love school, okay? I've been a nerd, an honors student, a professional academic since kindergarten. I was in honors from K through 12. So, you know, it wasn't school, it wasn't academia that made me nervous. You know, it wasn't the teachers or the principals that made me nervous. It was my peers. Because you see, it was a new school with new people. People who had not been in my elementary school because we had moved neighborhoods and there were different zones. But I was desperately afraid that what had happened to me in the building before would revisit itself in the building to come. I was right. I start my story in the middle because I wanted to basically point out the fact that even at 11, I had a couple of things going for me, which was one, I had self-awareness, and I knew that I was slightly different than the people around me, and two, I knew that what was happening to me was not just, and three, I knew that something about it needed to be fixed. I didn't know the fourth thing at all, which was how. So I guess that's why what happened happened. And so begins my bullying story. Now, actors, when they go up to on stage at the Golden Globes or the Oscars or whatever to receive an award, often bring a piece of paper so that they can remember who to thank, you know? Like their mom, their agent, God, their husband, the producers, HBO, you know, their kids, whatever, Sony. And I never understood that. I'm like, don't you have the people on hand in your noggin that you could just say? Isn't the information readily available to you? You know, I would be sure to thank my mother if I ever won anything, right? But I understand now why they had a piece of paper. I tonight sat down and just made my own notes because I didn't want to not give any honorable mentions to people, you know, people who sort of tried to destroy me. So I wrote down a couple of names and a couple of incidents just to make sure that I meant what I said and said what I meant. So, here we go. Now, I want first of all to address something. I'm wearing a hoodie tonight that has nothing to do with Ariana Grande. I'm wearing my Mother of Cavaliers hoodie. I'm wearing this because I am the mother of Cavaliers. I have Chloe the dog, and I will have Cavaliers till I die because they're my favorite breed of dog. And also, it's a reference to Game of Thrones and Daenerys Targaryen, or Khaleesi, who is basically a small blonde woman who, if you follow the program, spent the first half of her life being tortured and abused and not understood or believed, or just, you know, alternated between being invisible or highly visible to bullies. And when she finally got the guts to take her dragons and harness them and stand up for herself, they called her mad, like her dad, the Mad King. And the just punishment was, I guess, bestowed upon her. But I'm not going to ruin anything else in case you haven't seen the finale of Game of Thrones. I'm going to shut up there. Anyway, the thing is that I wanted to wear this today. I wanted to wear this because I am Daenerys Targaryen. I am a little blonde woman who spent the first half of her life being ignored or abused or treated with the utmost disrespect and treated like property and treated like a commodity and treated like a punching bag and or just simply not treated at all. And when the time finally came for me to stand up for myself and harness my dragons, I was mad. And it still happens to this day. So let's get into the bullying, shall we? Now, our story begins in 1982. If you've ever watched any of my videos, you'll know that this year I'll be 43, which puts me at 5 years old in 1982. And so 5 years old is when folks start kindergarten, so there I sat in kindergarten. My teacher's name was Mrs. Rothman. She was like about 278 years old. And she was kind of mean, but kind of nice. And what struck me about my class was that literally nobody knew how to read and write except for me. I remember sitting there, they were learning the letter A, and like it was funny because a kid drew on the blackboard, he went up to write the line. Like she told us, strike down, cross. And this kid went, and she yelled at him like he had just burnt down an orphanage. You know, she was like, "We never go up, dear God, we never go up." And I was like, "Lady, calm down," you know. So that was my more interesting moments of kindergarten. But the first time I actually remember being bullied, per se, or experiencing some negativity from my peers, happened with this person that is actually a doctor now. I looked her up on Facebook. We'll call her A. Now, A was in my classes from pretty much kindergarten through 12th grade. So I know A pretty well. And A, as I said, is now a doctor and she has a husband and children. But before that, she was a five-year-old like me. And A was sitting behind me in assembly one day. And I heard someone mention my name. So I like did the not turn around, turn around, right? And to be like, "Oh, what's up?" You know. And I heard A say, "Something, something, something, Linda, she's an asshole." Now, my first inclination was to giggle because I was five. And I thought, well, I know the definition of asshole. How do you know the definition of asshole? That's a bad word. And, you know, it was like, tee-hee. But then it morphed more into a, "Hey, no, I'm not." And I wasn't horrified and I didn't cry. I didn't yell at her. I was just like, "Lady, no." You know, much like Mrs. Rothman, you know, I was like, "Dude, seriously, not it." But I wasn't like upset, you know. Well, I didn't stay that upset for long. Because slowly but surely, as the year transpired, it became obvious to people that a couple of things were true of me. Number one, I was scary mature. Like I was one of those old ladies when I was born. Like everyone always talks about having an inner child, you know, and when you go to therapy, they're like, "What does your inner child feel?" I don't have one of those. Ever since birth, I've had an inner middle-aged lady, you know, like if you cut me open, the Golden Girls will pour out, you know, and this was true when I was five. So people didn't quite compute that. They didn't like understand how to do that with me, you know, and how to communicate. And so understandably, they didn't want to be my friend. So it's weird. Listen, that's even not the worst part. That's okay. I'm going to live with it because I don't know that I want to be their friends either. But the taunting and the laughter at all of my mistakes started to become more readily available. And I didn't exactly know what the hell to do. So a vicious cycle ensued in which they made fun of me, so I began to cry. and I cried because they were making fun of me. See how that works? So that was a bit of an issue, especially when it came to arts and crafts, because now I'm really artsy craftsy. Like, I'm all DIYing, like, you know, I got like burlap ribbon making, you know, Scotch plaid Christmassy things, and, you know, just like hot gluing shit and whatnot. But back in the day, I couldn't draw a straight line with a ruler, you know? I taught myself art as an adult. So I was not artistically inclined as a kid, and so I couldn't do the project. I couldn't glue the paper chains or whatever. So, like, people would be like, oh my God, she's so stupid. How does she not know how to do this? Meanwhile, I'm thinking, you know, I'm 5 and I'm reading at a 6th grade reading level, so who's stupid now? But I digress. So it just happened that way. There was one girl who we'll call M, who sat at my table, who routinely made fun of me. There were 5 guys named Joseph who routinely made fun of me. I'll say their names Joseph simply because of the 5, you know, because it's just that many Joseph. So, like, ha, Joseph F, Joseph C, Joseph M, I still remember. And in any case, we graduated from kindergarten and we went to 1st grade. And that is when I really noticed that it started to come about. In 1st grade, my most prevalent memory was this little doll. I had this little doll. She was weird. She was blue. I mean, she wasn't blue. Like, she wore like a blue outfit. She was like this big. And I got her in Queens, because most of my relatives have always lived in Queens. And there was this little discount store called Lewis of Woodhaven. And Lewis's had everything for like a dollar. And so I got this little baby doll for a dollar. She had a little tiny blue carriage crib thing that she lived in. And she was really, really cute and like blonde hair, because I always have blonde dolls, because, you know. So I brought it to school one day for like show and tell, and there was a girl in the schoolyard and she wanted to play with her. So she played with her and she like kept her, and she was like, okay, so like, I'll make you an arrangement. I'll take her on Tuesday and then you could have her on Wednesday. And then Wednesday came and she wouldn't give it back. And she's like, okay, I'll make you another arrangement. And basically she was stealing my property. Right? Now, I was 6 and I didn't know how to defend myself, because I don't know that I'd ever been the victim of theft, you know? So I was like, no. And I went and I told my mother, and she basically tried to teach me how to have balls and get my shit back, you know? But I, by this time, was a little bit beaten down by all the laughter, so I didn't know quite what to do to defend myself, so I did not. Now, I want to skip ahead a little and tell you not every specific thing that happened to me ever, but some of the situations that, or some of the, I guess, some of the motifs that went on during elementary school. Non-ethnicity was a huge issue, okay? I am Irish, I am Norwegian. Those are my ethnicities, primarily. And so my last name is McManus. You know, my mother's maiden name is Johnson, so there. And my classmates, except for 2 girls who were black, were exclusively Italian. And so different, as I indicated in the previous video about aesthetics, means bad. You know, when you're little, I guess. Maybe it's different today. I don't know. This is 35 years ago. And so they assumed that I was yucky. And so when we had ethnic day, they would, you know, taunt me like, ew, what's that, Norwegian? Ew, shepherd's pie, that's gross, that's not pasta. And like, they would like refuse to sit with me, and they would like, you know, laugh at me in class if like anything happens. Like, one day I remember my loose leaf paper was all upside down and I couldn't figure it out, and I became like almost tearful, and I was like, don't cry, they're gonna look at you, don't cry, they're gonna look at you. Practicing for the dance festival, which is something we did every June in the schoolyard, and the parents came and watched you do little dances, like the maypole or the Mexican hat dance or whatever. I remember having a total meltdown one day because they had this thing, they had this game that they were playing where they routinely stepped on my toes until I cried so that they would say that I was crying. We had a school trip once, and my mother chaperoned at the last minute because a friend of hers couldn't make it. This woman, Susan, she had a daughter named Romina, and she called her up and she said, hey, you know, Darlene, you want to go put my place? And my mother was like, sure. You know, she was a stay-at-home mom at the time. Nobody wanted to be in her group because, you know, you had to have a parent responsible for like every 10 kids or whatever. Nobody wanted to be in my group. They were like, ew, that's Linda's mother. If she's Linda's mother, she must be weird too. I'm not going to take orders from Linda's mother. That's disgusting. Who does she think she is? And so they hated my poor mother by association, okay? Routinely had my shit dumped in a puddle every single day. Was, you know, like just being isolated and made to feel like I was absolutely nothing. And I got to tell you, for a long time I thought I was. And all of it sort of centered around three girls. We're going to call them J1, J2, and T. Now, J1's mother was a teacher at the school also. She was a really, really large woman who went by the name of Bunny. And I always found that hilariously ironic because she was huge and bunnies are not. And, you know, when you're 8, that shit's funny. And my mother would always try to throw me into social situations with these people. She was like, my kid needs to be normal, so I'm going to go and take her to T's birthday party. I'm going to go and make her hang out with J2. I'm going to go to J1's backyard barbecue party with Linda, you know, and make sure that she does this. We're going to take her to the place called the Painted Pot in Bay Ridge, Brooklyn, where you take ceramics and you paint them and design them, like vases, bowls, picture frames, what have you. I painted a heart-shaped picture frame pink, I'll never forget. And so it's understandable why the night before junior high school I freaked out, because I had just gone through 6 years of absolute torture. That, I mean, this video isn't long enough. Like, I don't want to talk about my whole experience to you. I mean, this video would be 7 hours long. YouTube won't even upload it, you know, if I told you everything that happened to me. And also, I don't know that I want to cry in front of you. So, like, I won't say everything, but, like, my dignity was stripped away, like 100%. My humanity was routinely stripped away every single day. Every day of my life was worse than the day before it, until the point where I honestly didn't even understand why I was on planet Earth. And when I was 9, my mother read my little diary. I had this little diary that was black with tiny pink hearts and a little lock that opened, and I got it for Christmas. And she read it because she was afraid that I was going to commit suicide. I was 9. Okay? Now, junior high school had to be, because that's what happens, right? So in our neighborhood, junior high school is 6th grade, 7th grade, 8th grade. I know that some places has middle school set at 7, 8, 9, but they used to do that around here. But my 5th grade year was the year that they decided 5th grade are seniors, so we had a double senior class, 5th and 6th, right? Anyway, so I go to 6th grade. And totally new people for the most part, you know. A, who's a doctor, was there, but mostly new people, right? So I knew that I was in for it when I sat in this class. You see, there was some sort of a miscommunication between my elementary school and my middle school about whether or not I should be in the honors program based on my 5th grade teacher. And so I had to sit for 2 weeks in the slower class. Now, the slower class had these kids in it, and we took science together, I remember, and we had a test. We'd learned for 2 weeks, and Mrs. Weinfeld gave us a test. And so everybody got their scores back, you know, and it was maybe a day or two before I was being transferred to the honors program. And Mrs. Weinfeld handed out the test papers, and like almost every person in the whole room failed. I'm getting a message on my answering machine. I guess they didn't leave a message. Oh well, we'll find out later. So Mrs. Weinfeld gives the test back, and I got a 92. And I was kind of pissed that it wasn't 100, but whatever. And people around me were getting like 23s and 58s and whatnot, right? And I was a little embarrassed for them. I said, oh, these poor guys. Like, I wasn't like, haha, you suck. I was more like, oh no, that's a shame. You know, like, what the heck? What gives, man? There was this girl sat next to me, actually, and I don't remember her name, but she was Hispanic, and she was really pretty. And she was so tiny, she might have been smaller than me. And she got her grade back, she got a 52. And she asked me what I got, and I showed her my 92. And she was like, really, like, she wasn't jealous, she was proud of me. She was like, oh, wow, that's awesome, how did you do that? 92, wow, you must be really smart. And I remember thinking, well, it's general science, like, it's no big deal, it's just review, you know? And actually, that's the first time it really occurred to me that not everybody had the same brain level, because, you know, I'd been in such an honors bubble all my life that I didn't realize that there were people who were advanced intelligence, medium intelligence, and special needs intelligence, you know, or just basic or whatever. I didn't know there were levels. I just was around people like me, you know, then again, not like me, because I was different and bullied, right? We all the same brain, though. Anyway, so junior high school was probably the worst 3 years of my life. And the reason for that was because of the violence, okay? At any given time, my bullying was more physical than ever before. At any given time, I could count on three different people in my grade that would routinely make my physical person feel threatened and abused. One person, we'll call her TR. TR would routinely walk up to my lunch table. We were forced to sit with our class, so there were no cliques. And she would routinely walk up to my lunch table, smack me hard as hell, like Rocky fucking Balboa, on the shoulder, and say, "There was a fly there," and walk away. Another girl, we'll call MC, was her friend, and routinely threatened to kick my ass. And when I said, "Well, my father is picking me up today," she said, "I don't give a shit. I'll smack your father too." From the asshole argument, was also friends with them, and I remember her egging them on and saying and like laughing when she said, "Oh, there was a fly there." She's like, "Yeah, there was. I was gonna get it, but," and then there was a boy. We'll call him S. S would leave English class. He sat directly in back of me, and he would leave English class every day. And as I was packing up my things to go, he would routinely take my physical person from the back and slam me into the desk so that the bone of my hip, like right at the, like the pelvic bone that shows when you're real skinny, would slam into the desk because it was right level, because he knew what my height, you know. This is also the same English class where there was this guy we'll call MB. And MB was told by somebody that I liked him. I kind of didn't, but whatever. And they said that. And so when we left English class, I read his desk and it said, "Fuck Linda McManus, stupid slut." And I thought, "Slut? I'm 11. I don't have boobs. What the fuck are you talking about?" Nevertheless, this went on for 3 years straight. There was one girl, we'll call S, who I remember as moving a chair in art class. Someone picked that moment to drop something into the trash and was walking back. So I said, "Oh, pardon me." And I took the chair and I moved it around them. And S goes, "Oh my God, what's with this girl? She's so fucking stupid. She doesn't understand how to move a chair. How is she in honors if she's that fucking stupid?" And literally not one teacher did anything about it. Not one person who were my peers stood up for me and said, "Leave her alone." Not one person came to my aid. Mostly people cheered on the situation and egged it on. Now, the grand culmination of the entire sixth grade bullying phenomenon, because there was a seventh and there was an eighth, but again, this video would be very long, came about 2 days or so before the end of the school year. It's funny because it was actually the last day of school that my mother announced that she was pregnant with my brother Kevin. So the school year came out rather nicely. But it was about 2 days left of the year, and we had a party in class. We brought, like, there were chips and donuts and stuff, you know, to celebrate the end of the school. So Mrs. Weinfeld, science class again, because she taught the two classes, the slower class and the honors class. So we're all sitting in Mrs. Weinfeld's science class, and AC, our doctor, and TA, or TR, I'm sorry, her friend, I'm getting my letters mixed up at this point. So basically, there was a fly there girl and the future doctor, right? The asshole lady, they were talking about some stuff, and I had mentioned that I hated grape jelly. I do. I hate grape jelly. Can't stand it. I will not even have it in my home. I won't go anywhere near it. I'm disgusted by grape jelly. I can't even describe it. So I mentioned it, right? So TR decided that that was hilarious. So she went and she took a jelly donut that she knew had grape in it, because she, like, took a bite and she was like, "Oh, it's jelly," right? And she was like, "Oh, it's grape." Chased me around the classroom as other people cheered and laughed with the donut, looking to smear it on me or in my face or make me eat it. So I refused to eat it. So she held me, like, back, and another girl held me back. And she was like, "Come on, eat it, eat it." And the grape jelly got all over my brand new white V-neck tee. And even then, you know, this is like 30 years ago, and you know I love my white V-neck tee, and it was destroyed. Now, it's a t-shirt, it's fine, but it was the embarrassment, it was the humiliation of the grape jelly that really did it. Mrs. Weinfeld was in the doorway talking to another teacher, so she missed it. I elected not to tell her, because I didn't want her to get in trouble for mismanaging her classroom, right? I'm a teacher, I know how that goes, right? Sometimes shit happens, and there's nothing you can do. I understand. So, next class of the day was English. So we're sitting in English class, and the whole group of people who had never been my friends before, right, and who had been my bullies throughout the year, surrounded me. But this time they were supportive. And they were like, that's effed up what TR did to you, and you have to say something about it because you can't just walk around with jelly like that, and that's really not cool, because like she was like, you know, she's like holding you back and like making you eat it, like that's really not cool. You should tell the dean, you should tell the dean. We had a dean named Mrs. Cox. And we had another dean named Mrs. Callejo, who was really scary. And so so we went together to the dean's office, A, and another person who we'll call MC. And we went to the dean. And I told the dean what TR had done with the grape jelly. And it was reported, and there was an incident report and so forth, right? And you got a referral from the dean. That was big time. And she said, do you want me to suspend TR? I said, no, I just want you to be made aware of the fact that TR did this to me in Mrs. Weifeld's science class. And next period comes. Nobody says anything to me. All right, fine. Next day comes. I was sitting in English class, and I'm surrounded by the same people again who told me how effed up it was that I reported TR, that I don't know how to take a joke, and because I got their friend in trouble, I better watch out on the last day of school because all of them are going to hold me down, tie me up in view of the whole school, and beat the living shit out of me for being a rat. I said, but you told me to do that. We said, well, do you always do everything you're told to do? And so the incident ensued. My father picked me up from school. I did not get my ass kicked, and I left school. And this was, I have to say to this day, one of the most humiliating things I've ever gone through. I mean, it happened in 1989. It's 30 years later, and I think about it often. Like, I think about it, like, I'd have to say, like, once a week, you know, and it could still reduce me to tears. Because, listen, I'll get over grape jelly. That's not the point. It's the manner in which it was done, and it's the fact that I had no control over it, and it's the fact that it was for no fucking reason at all, and it was the fact that I was 11 and I was not equipped to defend myself, and I feel guilty of myself that I didn't have chutzpah, you know, I didn't have guts, I didn't have the wherewithal to be like, yo, step off, you know. I was just like, I'll take it. It was just like, welcome was tattooed on my forehead because I didn't know how else to be. And I'm mad at myself that I didn't have balls, you know? And I'm mad at them for being so narrow-minded. And I'm mad at the schools for not understanding that this was occurring and that it was that serious. And for a while, I was mad at my parents because they didn't quite know how to handle it. In my mother's defense, she was 20 when she had me. So that meant that at this time in life, she was 32. And I remember being 32. And she was doing what she could, you know? She thought maybe in elementary school, if she put me with these people, that they would warm up to me and be my friends and see that I was great, because my mother loved me. She thought I was great. She still does. So she said, well, you know, if I think Linda's cool, maybe she's cool. So, like, people will think she's cool. Like, people will see the beauty that I see. That never occurred. So then she was like, all right, so being their friend is not a good idea. So why don't we just, like, avoid them at all costs? You know, just go through the motions, do your schoolwork, and, like, say F it and just not even associate, right? Well, I tried that, and I got the grape jelly, okay? You know, why don't you report the incident? You know, why don't you say what's happening to you to the authorities, and the authorities will handle it? I got threatened to get held down and get my ass kicked in front of the security guards and my father for reporting the wrong. Okay, so everything I did to thwart the situation, killing them with kindness, killing them with meanness, not killing them at all, you know, trying to move away from them, changing buildings, you know, like, all the things that I did were to no avail at all. And I by the time I graduated from junior high school, I went to Shallow Junior High School, IS 227 in Brooklyn, New York. I graduated in 1991. And, I mean, as sure as I still know the Shallow song, and everybody in my, like, whole neighborhood knows the Shallow song, I also know that I couldn't sing it with a straight face because those were not happy times. You know, at one point the song says, Shallow, shallow, we will always hallow the lessons that you taught, the happiness you brought to us during each school year. And I thought, well, okay, first of all, there was no friggin' happiness. And second of all, the lesson that I was taught was that I'm just a poor, pathetic, little, blonde, miniature person who has to shut up and take it, you know, and that I'm worth nothing, and that nobody will ever think of me as interesting, cool, or even a human, and that I should just keep my mouth shut, keep my nose clean, and sit in the corner. You know, that's the lesson that they taught, you know, and they didn't bring any friggin' happiness, like I said, you know. And when we sang the last part of the song, Graduation, so let's give a mighty cheer to Shallow, Shallow, here, here, here. My lyrics in my head were, so let's give a mighty cheer to Shallow, Shallow, because I'm leaving here. And I did. And I lived. And I went to high school. And I didn't make any friends. And, well, no, that's not true. I had one friend who was male, but he liked me because he liked me. I didn't like him back. And I talked to one or two people at a lunch table a few times, you know. And people were decent to me. People weren't my friends, but they were not my bullies. I can honestly say that in high school I was not bullied. I was left alone. Grades 9 through 12, not one bad incident happened to me. But not one good one did, so I'll take it. It's been half an hour since I've been rattling on about bullying. I'm gonna get to my point now about you. We've talked about me, okay? What's the lesson in all this? What do we learn here? How do we get past all of this? How do we not grow up to be like me, using a Game of Thrones inspired hoodie with dogs on it to teach us that we have the power? How do we not spend half an hour in our bedrooms talking into our phones? I have to kick it old school because my camera memory card is full, so I'm on my phone. How do we not spend our nights doing that and trying to hold back tears as we talk about shit that happened 35 years ago? How do we do that? Well, it's simple. Don't do what the people around me did, okay? Don't do what I did. I mean, I could say don't bully other people, but we know what's going to occur. Now, lots of schools now have zero tolerance policies about bullying, and there's all kinds of campaigns against bullying. Lady Gaga, who I worship and love, has the It Gets Better campaign, trying to teach people who are different in any way, or people who are gay and trying to come out or something, that you don't have to stand up for, that you don't need to stand for such bullshit, and that you are a person too, and that when you get older, these things go away. And I gotta tell you, I've been waiting for years. I mean, I graduated from Shallow in 1991. It's 2020. I've been waiting for a day when people understand that bullying isn't kids being kids, you know? Like, when people say, oh, you can't hold much stock in that, teenage girls are mean, or, oh, boys will be boys. Just because something is doesn't mean it's good. Charles Manson was a serial killer. Did we say, that's just Charlie? No. Son of Sam shot people. You say, that's just David. You know, no, that's incorrect, okay? Priests routinely, like, rape little boys. Do we say, ah, that's just Father Tom being Father Tom? You know, no. Things that are wrong aren't just who you are. You have to ameliorate that. You have to fix that. You have to look at a broken system and you have to say, what the hell can we do differently? And I've got some pointers. Pointer number one, change schools if it's that bad. Recently, I've been watching Nikki and Gabby videos, and both Nikki and Gabby DiMartino have suggested that changing schools midway through the seventh grade after their bullying problem solved it all. And they met friends that they have to this day, including Thomas Hughes, who directs all their videos. And, you know, seek help from the authorities in your school without announcing it. Do it, like, on the DL, right? Do not, if you can, give any ammunition to your bully or stand out in any way. Fade into the scenery until the situation alleviates, because if you give any, like, credence to their fight, they will fight you. And probably last but not least, I will say, you're gonna be an adult one day, you know, and sure, you might be talking about it into your camera one day, but other things happen to you that are wonderful. I've had wonderful things bestowed upon me in these last 20 years. I mean, hell, I've had some excellent times out with people in my adult life. You know, I've raised two beautiful dogs. I've experienced the love of two beautiful senior cats. I have I've been to Paris. I've been to Montenegro. I've been to Israel. I've been to the Republic of Georgia. I've eaten New England clam chowder in a bread bowl in Boston, Massachusetts. I've put my feet in the Pacific Ocean. You know, I've done wonderful things. I've been teaching for 20 years. I've been on a boat in the middle of the Adriatic Sea in a bikini. You know, I've had wonderful things happen to me. It's just such a damn shame that these negative experiences come back into my mind every so often, even when I'm on a boat, or even when I'm in Paris, or even when I'm loving up on my dog. You know, parents, if your child is the bully, you tell them to knock that shit off. You explain to them that every human being, no matter how different they may be, has dignity and should be treated as such. Because if the shoe were on the other foot, they would not be happy at all. Parents of the child being bullied, hear their concerns. Listen to them as if they're 45 and at the therapist. Don't listen to them like they're a kid. They are a kid and they're your kid. It's not a kid's problem. It's a human's problem. Don't listen to your kid like he's 7. Don't listen to your kid like he's 13. Listen to your kid like he's 50, okay? Because only then will you understand the humanity of the problem and that it's not just kids being kids. And if so, contact the proper authorities and make teachers aware. Because I could tell you as a teacher, we're not always aware. We're very understaffed, overworked. There are 34 children in the room sometimes, sometimes in other states more. And things slip by us. And we're sorry. And we want to help you. So, there. This has been a long video, but it's been absolutely worth it. And I now teach in a building that is, it's actually my old high school, like I teach in the high school that I went to, and it is around the corner from the place where all the bullying started, PS 204, the Vince Lombardi School. And I'm not ashamed to say this, I'm not worried about being stalked because, you know, I welcome the chance to meet a person and say, hey, this is my experience. Share your experience, you know, I'm open to it. Like, I would love to see people face to face and discuss it. You know, I'm not hiding out like a, you know, like Michael Jackson or anything, you know. Anyway, I do want to make sure that I've listed everything on this paper. And I think that I have. And I think that I do want to say that there have been some excellent people along the way who made my school experience very palatable. I want to give a shout out to a couple of teachers now because they changed me for the better. Wherever you are, Celia Rossi, you were so unbelievably great. Your son Paul taught us how to draw Smurfs. You had a bad back and you wore slippers. You gave us candy during the spelling bee. We had our picture taken together during the play about how April wouldn't cry so there were no April showers. And I played May. And I was the flowers. And you were unbelievable. So much so that you promoted with us to the third grade because we couldn't bear to be without you. Marie Riley, you became the principal after I left, and I saw you years later in the hair salon, and I just thought, wow, nobody knows that that unassuming little blonde woman is the principal of a whole school. And coming off of Mrs. Rossi was tough, but you made me feel welcome and educated, and you were an excellent, excellent teacher and an excellent principal. And I think you're retired now, and congratulations to you. And finally, to Jerry Stallonis. We met in my 11th grade year, and I know you're still around, and I know you're retired now because we worked together for the first year of my career. And I just want to say, you're the reason I'm an English teacher. You're the reason I love The Great Gatsby. You're the reason I love The Catcher in the Rye. And you're the reason why every single day I go into New Utrecht, a school that you taught at, and I, to the best of my ability, make sure that the kids are instructed and behaving, but also heard, understood, welcome, not bullied, and taught deeper than just the text. Taught about life. Taught about what it means to be a decent human being, and to visit that upon other decent human beings, and to not live in a world where little blonde girls have panic attacks in the middle of Who Framed Roger Rabbit because they're afraid of the people around them. You three are probably the reason why I'm a teacher, and you three are also probably the reason why I maintain some semblance of sanity throughout my career in New York City public schools as a student. I thank you immensely, and I hope that your 2020, if you guys are still around, is incredible and awesome, and that you deserve every blissful moment of retirement you have. This has been my bullying video. This has been my story. These are my notes. This is my mother of Cavaliers tea. My Cavalier's over there. So I'm gonna go and get her and tell her she's cute and spend some time with her. And then I'm gonna watch some YouTube because that's what I do. So, until next time, just keep hanging in there because Lady Gaga's campaign is right. It does get better. Good night.